so I can help you out.
No, you're good.
Yep, all right. Morning. How you doing? Friends, the Lord be with you.
Also with you.
As you can see, it's the third Sunday after Pentecost, and you can see that lovely icon there is a picture of a mustard seed growing into a tree. The gospel readings this morning talk about the growing garden, my favorite parable, and the parable of the mustard seed. In the sermon this morning, we're going to be hearing the second last part of our series on the 23rd Psalm, God's antidote to our hurts. Let us stand. Once again, the Lord be with you.
Also with you.
Sing our opening hymn as we think about healing and growth. We sing, Water, You Turned Into Wine.
Thank you.
blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be his kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
It's a great joy to welcome you to our service this morning of Holy Communion, a celebration of God's healing in our hearts as we have the penultimate sermon this morning in the Psalm 23 series. We do invite you to stay after church for lunch. We have a free lunch today. It's donated by one of our members to celebrate a big life event that they're giving thanks for, so do please join us. It also happens to be Matt's 20th birthday. Where's Matt? I think there's a little boy called Eiffel, so happy birthday as well, so happy birthday Eiffel. Yeah. Let us turn to one another and say good morning and welcome to church. It's lovely to see you.
Good morning.
Good morning. Let us pray and cry for pure hearts as we come to sing our praises to the Lord this morning and sing glory to Him. We prepare our hearts by praying for the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. We pray together, Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Now, during this wrapping up praise and worship, there are two action songs. The first one is Blessed Be the Name of the Lord. And I think we do Blessed Be the Name of the Lord. And then when we get to the chorus, go to the next slide, you remember the action to go the name of the Lord. So we point out between hands, the name of the Lord is my strong tower. The righteous run into it and they are saved. It's very simple, I think you know it. And then when we get later on to Raise a Hallelujah, Sal's going to lead us in a congregational action for Raise a Hallelujah. Thank you, B. Let's praise the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord.
Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord.
good shepherd who soothes and heals our wounds. You bring us into a table that you prepare in the presence of our enemies. You anoint us with oil to heal us. You fill our cup to overflowing with joy and hope and love. We look to you, Lord. You are our beginning and our end. We love you, Jesus, good shepherd of our soul.
Thank you.
pray our colleagues are our theme prayer. The Lord be with you.
And also
with you. We pray together, Almighty God, keep our Lord, your household, the church, in your steadfast faith and love, that through your grace we may proclaim your truth and boldness, and minister your justice with compassion. For the sake of our Savior Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Please be seated. I'd like to thank the music team for the beautiful worship this morning, guys. It's so beautiful for me. And I'd like to thank Ali Sal for leading us in those very beautiful, what are actually creative? Didn't you think? I thought it was really stunningly beautiful and creative. Thank you so much. It's not just your ordinary action song by Ali Sal, is it? It's really the work of art. Thank you. That's a tribute, of course. Well, we're going to have our first reading this morning, which is read to us by Molly. Welcome, Molly. And the readings you'll notice are all about gardens and trees and things.
Word in the world.
So it's the kingdom of God at work in and through us in the world. So it's us, we are the tree. Turn to your neighbor and say, you are the tree. Now turn to your neighbor and say, you're also the garden.
You're the garden.
You're also the garden. Okay. Let's turn to the psalm. The psalm is on page 2 of your bulletin, and it's Psalm 92. Well done, David. David, where's the job? Amen. David, did you think that you were wrong when I didn't react? Or did you still know you were right? Did you know you were right when I didn't react? I'm not getting any feedback. All right. I owe you a chocolate, baby. Psalm 92. Let us say from side to side by whole verse, beginning on this side. It is a good thing to give thanks to the Lord and to sing praises to your name, O Most High. This reading comes from 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verses 6 to 10 and 14 to 17. We are always confident. Even though we know that while we are at home in the body, we are away from the Lord. But we walk by faith, not by sight. Yes, we do have confidence, but we would rather be away from the body than at home in the Lord. So whether we are at home or away, we make it our aim to please Him. For all of us must appear before the judgment seat of Christ, so that each may receive recompense for what has been done within the body, whether good or evil. For the love of Christ urges us on, because we are convinced that one has died for all. Therefore, all have died. And He died for all, so that those who live might live no longer for themselves, but for Him who died and was raised to them. From now on, therefore, we regard no one from a human point of view. Even though we once knew Christ from a human point of view, we know Him no longer in that way. So if anyone is in Christ, there is a new creation. Everything old has passed away. See, everything has become new. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
I'm going to do a little song this morning. And this is a gentle little children's song. It's really kind of aimed more at Happy Meal, I think. It's not like last week we were rocking the Casbah. What did we sing last week? Remember? I am strong man. You remember? Listen to Happy. One more. Will you sound the whole line up, okay? So, because one must we go to another, one must show the precious plans we all work in unity to tend the garden of love.
Let's do that together.
As they were able to hear it. He did not speak to them except in parables,
but he explained everything in private to his disciples. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Some of the music team singers will also sign.
Everybody is welcome to sign up for the coming singing workshop to enhance our worship together. There's lots of information about the summer camp. We haven't signed a contract. They sent us the contract at 6 p.m. on Friday, so I have to read it, study it with Miss Lucy, and send it back to them with a deposit. But we're 95% got it locked in, so it's all reserved. And I'm really, really thrilled this morning to announce that Pastor Chris will be leading the 7 to 12s, and that Miss Vivian will be leading the 2 to 6s again. Isn't that great? I'm so happy about that. Super great. Sadly, Miss Crystal will not make it back. I thought she would, but she's going to be coming back a couple of days after camp. So she's going to miss this one again. But nevertheless, we have Chris and Vivian, which I'm super, super thrilled about. We have wonderful children's breakout rooms. They're really nice breakout rooms for the kids program on the 17th floor. It's going to be a great camp. Our focus will be on prayer ministry, how to pray for people. So we'll be continuing the theme both of prayer and of the gifts of the Spirit, how to use the gifts of the Spirit in praying for others. This is something we should all participate in small groups or in church where we have to pray for one another. We should all be able to pray for one another. And this weekend we'll give you a simple theological outline together with some simple models. And if you look in the bulletin, there's a summary on page 10 at the bottom of what we'll be looking at. We're going to be looking at how to help someone become a Christian, how to pray with them to receive Christ, how to pray for someone to be filled with the Holy Spirit, how to pray for healing for someone without making them sick, and how to listen to God and exercise gifts of the Spirit in prayer ministry. So I'm really excited about this weekend. It will be a new experience for me as well as for you, but I believe that the Lord will be with us and that God is going to do some exciting things among us on that weekend. All the notices are there as usual. We're still looking for people to do massage for Alice. We have a small team of people who are doing that on a regular basis, several times a week. It's not difficult. Any intelligent and capable adult can do it. And it would really be appreciated to get me in and be in the break sometimes to do the back padding and the simple movement exercises. It's nothing to be afraid of, and it's a very good Christian thing to do to minister to Alice in that way. He's still our brother, he's still with us, and we're still trying to care for him. So we would like to build up that team. If you would feel called to do that, please see me or Miss Noah Dunhas or Imelda. They're involved in doing it. I'd also like to draw your attention to page 19. In July, our diocesan synod, the Anglican Church, is divided into political areas called dioceses. And in Macau, we're not a diocese because we're just a missionary area. We're kind of like a baby church. We haven't grown up yet. But some years ago, the single way in Hong Kong and Macau promised the Anglican Communion that Macau would be becoming a diocese soon. Because you need to have four dioceses to make a province. And at the moment, the single boy only has 3.5 dioceses. We are the half. So they want us to grow up and become a diocese, which means we need a bishop and diocesan office. And you can see that there's some notice about that on page 19, that is already, the process for that has begun. They've already set up committees to plan the ordination of the bishop and the search to find the bishop. But also, if you look down on page 19 there, there's a motion that's being brought to synod. Now, our synod members are John Arteta, Robert Alexander, and Marlene Mayer. And there's a motion that we're going to be voting on that Chinese missions should be launched at Macau Anglican College. Now, I wasn't consulted about this, of course. I'm a small peanut in the organization. However, it means that they want to have a Chinese-speaking congregation here in that school. So we can only welcome that, of course. That's wonderful news. So the Diocese of Macau will be working towards that in the future. It may mean that there's a priest here. Maybe there's another priest, a Chinese-speaking priest, who may actually become the school chaplain. So to me, I'm not sure yet how it will work. But it's all good. It's about growth. And there are many, many, many families in the school who are Chinese-speaking. The English may not be good enough to come to this church, but maybe they would like to go to a Chinese-speaking church. So we would probably have to share the building in future. So that's all right. This is exciting things planned for the future.
All right, so please read this. I haven't covered everything by any means. Please take it home, don't throw it away. If nothing else, use this as a prayer guide. You can go through it when you see your young adults, children, youth, whatever, pray for them. Use it as a prayer outline. All right, let's stand. And since we know Andrew, let's hold hands again. And we're going to sing, may God's blessing surround you each day. turn to page 17, that's the outline. Does anybody need a pen? If you need a pen, coming around with a pen shop. Alrighty. So wait, this is the penultimate message in the series on the 23rd Psalm. Penultimate is the one for the end. Is anybody cold? You put up a hand and wave it if you're cold. Okay, so because you're close to the end, we're in the back. Miss Lani, are you here? Lani? She's out. Okay. Matthias, can you call them and ask them to make it 1-8 instead of 2? But don't ask them to turn it off, ever. Alright, thank you, brother. So we're going to look this morning at God's antidote to our hurt. We live in an imperfect world, and because we live in an imperfect world, we're going to get hurt. There are many churches, or some churches, that teach that if you're in the kingdom of God, you will not get hurt. It's a false doctrine, it's not what Jesus taught. But there are churches that tell you that if you are living in the kingdom, then you will only have prosperity and good health. And if you're not in good health, then you're sinning, and it's your fault, and you're outside of good theology and the will of God. Actually, I was teaching in a school in Hong Kong, and there was a teacher in the school there who went to a church in Hong Kong which taught this kind of theology. And I mentioned in a talk to the students one day that in life we face difficulties and sickness and troubles. That's part of the life for Christians as well as non-Christians. And she came afterwards and rebuked me. And she said, no, you're wrong. If we are in the kingdom of God and we're Christians, we will not get sick and we will not have trouble and we will have victory all the time. And I'm here to tell you today that this is just humbug. And it's not what Jesus taught. Jesus taught, in this world, you will have trouble. It's true, he went on and he said, fear not, I've overcome the world. But I think that he meant spiritually and in the long run. Now, of course, we live in the now, but not yet the kingdom. We do encounter healing. We do encounter answers to prayer and miracles. And these are outbreakings, outworkings of the kingdom of God among us. But the kingdom of God is not yet come in all its fullness. Of course, we hope and pray that it will come in greater fullness and greater measure among us all. And we seek for that as God's people. But nevertheless, we find ourselves with a foot in two kingdoms. We have a foot in the kingdom of this world with its brokenness, its sin and death and suffering and disease. And we have a foot in the kingdom of heaven with its joy and hope and life and healing and assurance of salvation. And we live, as it were, like those fish which can live in the ocean, they can also breathe in the ocean, they have gills, and they can also breathe on the land. We have both gills and lungs. We live in the world, but we also live in the kingdom of God. We are simultaneously in two kingdoms. But we pray, your kingdom come, your will be done. We pray that God's kingdom will come more and more and in greater measure. So we encounter old age and sickness and trouble and so forth. And invariably, these sort of congregations that teach this don't last very long because, the pastor will be preaching that you don't get sick, and if you do, it's because of sin, and you should always be prosperous and everything go well, and the next thing you know, there'll be a pandemic, and the pastor will get the disease and die, or the pastor will get cancer, or something will go wrong, because it's simply not true. And we are all subject to the challenges and changes of this world. And Jesus told us that we also would go through difficulties. The scripture says that though you go through the fire, you will not be burned. Although we go through difficult times, the Lord will carry us through and he will be with us. So, we do have accidents, for example, and I'm exhibit A number one. Once again, I find myself preaching to you from my own experience. And once again, I just want to clarify that I'm not doing that because I'm looking for medical advice, although Dr. Lindy, I wouldn't mind seeing you after service. But I don't necessarily want to see everybody else's medical advice. I know what things I need to do. But accidents do happen. Yesterday at youth group, I hadn't played basketball for quite a while at youth group because I've been blowing whistle and walking up and down the sideline where it's safe. But our youth leaders are rising up and they don't really need me anymore, so it's an okay night, you know, you lead the game at the end of basketball. And so I thought, oh, I want to play, because I used to love playing. So I got in and I played. And three quarters of the way through the game, I made a little jump, and as I came down, something went snap, crackle and pop. Actually just went snap. Something popped in my knee, and I found an excruciating pain in my right leg and couldn't put weight on it. Seems to me miraculously somewhat better. I don't know if it's the osteopanadol I've taken or my wife's prayers, or possibly a combination of both. But I'm astounded that I'm as good as I am. Last night, I couldn't get from here to there without crawling, basically. And this morning when I woke up, I was much the same. I could barely get to the shower, but here I am walking around doing action songs. So I don't know if that's adrenaline stupidity or if it's prayers of panadol. But anyway, it's good. So maybe I'm not as I thought I was. But nevertheless, the point is that accidents happen. And we can't predict it. We said last week when we go through dark valleys, valley of the shadow of death, it's impartial and it's unexpected. We don't know when we're going to encounter deep valleys. What we can know for sure is that at some point we'll have to go through a dark valley or two in life. And at some point it can happen to us. And being a Christian doesn't exempt us from the difficulties and the dark valleys of life. Now, when people go through troubles, the thing that hurts us the most is what? Is it sickness or poverty or accidents? I don't think so. I think the thing that hurts us the most is human beings, including ourselves, as people. People hurt us, sometimes intentionally, sometimes unintentionally, sometimes accidentally, sometimes they do it on purpose, but they wish they didn't, or they don't mean it. We're very complicated. But we hurt one another, and we hurt. And I think that the hurts that we do to ourselves and to one another as human beings are oftentimes worse than the hurts of the body. This is why teenage girls cut themselves with razors and things, because they do it to submerge the emotional pain of whatever trauma or emotional abuse they have, or imagine that they have, or they have. They do it to submerge that emotional pain under the physical pain. So the physical pain is a distraction from the emotional turmoil and pain that they've gone through. And they feel that the physical pain is not as bad. They would rather think about the physical pain than the emotional trauma that they've experienced in life. But I don't mean to minimize that. I've had a number of young friends who've gone through that, and it's a terrible thing. And they both said to me that they did it to distract themselves from the emotional pain that they were going through. So we hurt, and our emotional hurts are very often more painful than even our physical hurts, although physical hurts can be pretty terrible too. Now, when we go through these things, we need God's antidote to our hurts. The problem is, we are like those Wild West snake oil salesmen. We manufacture our own antidotes, and they invariably make the problem worse. You know, in the Wild West in America, there were guys who would travel around with their wagon. You see it in the Western movies, and they would be selling so-called snake oil. They would be selling some magical cure, the cure-all, so-called cure-all. And it probably had some arsenic in it, and some heroin or something, feel better. But it would invariably make the condition worse. Maybe they would become addicted to the cure-all. And we're like that. We manufacture antidotes for our pain, and they invariably make us worse. So before we can look at God's antidotes and what Scripture has told us that God wants us to have to heal our hearts, we need to get rid of the things that we manufacture. So first of all, I want to outline for you five things that we should not do when we hurt. And that's the five things on page 17 in your bulletin. So the first thing that you should not do, and I'm going to be exhibit number one this point, is don't ignore it. This is the Clint Eastwood approach to pain. Suffer in silence, tough it out, bite the bullet, be a macho man, don't cry, pretend it doesn't exist, hope it will go away, and just try to cope with your hurt by pretending it's not there. So I'm currently fully into that at the moment. And there are several ways that we do this. Let me mention three ways. One way is just simply what we call denial. We simply cause ourselves to believe that it's not real, it's not really a problem. We even believe that someone has to die. I know a number of cases in Australia when I was taking funerals where little old man would pass away and a little old lady would set out a shirt, iron his shirt and pants every morning, and put them out for him to wear. And she would put his breakfast on the table because she'd been doing that for 50 years. And because she couldn't bear to accept that he was gone. So that's called denial. When you're ironing your husband's pants and shirt when he's older and in the grave, then you're not really exactly living in reality. And it's very difficult for her friends to watch. So her well-meaning friends did a terrible thing. All the ladies from church came in, and they packed up all her husband's shirts and pants while she was out of the house and took them off to the Goodwill to the Salvation Army. It's a terrible thing to do. It's like, what have you guys done? It was so bad. And so the poor lady couldn't iron her husband's shirt and pants anymore, as was her way of grieving. So don't ever do that to anybody. If they're ironing their husband's shirts and pants after he's gone, just let them iron for a while. We can be very silly sometimes. So denial. We can just deny that there's a problem. We cannot acknowledge that our child's condition is incurable. Even the doctors are telling us there's no cure. You need to prepare yourself for death. You need to treasure the time that you have. Parent will not believe it. They will live in denial. They will seek every possible cure, but they can't even know there is no cure for the incurable. So we have denial. Secondly, we minimize. We say, well, and this is usually from our perspective, when we're injured, we say, well, it's no big deal. I'm okay. I'm not actually an agony. That's all right. You know, this goes hand in hand with toughing it out, the Clint Eastwood approach. The third one is we procrastinate. We postpone doing something about it. We wait until after church on Sunday. We wait until the next day, Monday. We sweep it under the carpet. One of these days, I will get around to it. One of these days, I will take care of my hurt and my problem. When my father joined the public service as a young man, his first job was in the civil service in Australia, in Victoria actually, State of Victoria, in the Education Department. And he encountered a senior officer who took him into his office and said, "No, I'm going to teach you the secret of being a successful civil servant. The secret of successful civil service is something that we call masterly inactivity." Masterly inactivity means you don't do something if someone else can do it, or if you wait long enough, someone else will do it, or you just don't do anything, you see. It's not simply inactivity, it's masterly inactivity, because you have to have the skill of knowing when to be inactive and to do nothing. And the name for that is procrastination, of course. So it was kind of humorous, but it's also humorous because it's a public service. But basically, many public servants in many countries survive by keeping their head down. You know, if you stick your head up above the parapet, you get shot off. So if you're in the public service, you keep your head down, don't make waves, and you keep your job. So my dad's mentor was teaching him masterly inactivity, David. Don't stick your head up above the parapet. Someone will shoot it off. And what he was teaching him was to procrastinate. If you put it off long enough, maybe someone else will do it for you, and that can get in trouble instead of you. So the first thing that we would say about that is don't ignore it. Don't deny it, don't minimize it, don't procrastinate it. But face it. In Psalm 39, David says, "I kept very quiet, but I became even more upset. I became very angry inside. And as I thought about the problem, my anger burned." So procrastination turns molehills into a mountain. It turns a little flame into a forest fire. So don't do that. Don't ignore it. The second point of the 5 points that we should not do is don't run away from it. This is what I famously call the geographical solution. People will move house, they will, you know, it's the song, "Get Out the Back Jack," you know, "Make New Plans," Dan. You know that song, 50 Ways to Leave Your Lover. You know, you could just leave, get on a bus, guys. Don't need to discuss much. Just set yourself free. You're going to run away. Basically, it's the runaway, the geographical approach. But we are not called to run. If we run, again, it just gets worse. David tried it. In Psalm 55, there's a verse which has been immortalized in American Midwestern folk songs. "I wish I had the wings of a dove, and I would fly away and rest. I would hurry to my place of escape." David was longing to have the wings of a dove so that he could exercise the geographical solution and fly away. When we travel, in some degree, we may be exercising the geographical solution for a short term. You know, you just want to get on a cruise and get out of Dodge. And I don't think there's necessarily anything wrong with that. But the problem is, we all know, when we come back from the cruise, the problem is still there, right? And not only the problem is still there, but now you have a bill for thousands and thousands of dollars as well. So things get worse when we run away from them. If we may run away with movies, or with media, or with television, or alcohol, or drugs, or even divorce, or even Disneyland, anywhere, cruises, anything that we can do to escape, we can run away from reality. The problem is that when we come down from being high, or from eating too much, or whatever, the problem is still there, and in addition, we have a hangover, a debt, and maybe another 5 kilos. Nothing has changed. Things get worse. The third thing that we should not do is don't hide your hurt. Some people don't run or ignore their hurt, but they hide it. They keep it to themselves and don't tell anybody. We call this wearing a mask. We wear masks. We put on our happy face. Some of you are quite good at camouflaging your pain and wearing metaphorical masks as well as actual ones. Now, of course, we have permission to wear actual masks as well as metaphorical masks, which, if you're a mask wearer, a metaphorical mask wearer, is really good, because you can actually hide your facial expression as well. And sometimes we play a game called, is something wrong? We always, when someone comes and says, how are you? I came in this morning, several people looked at me all week and said, are you all right? Yes, I'm wonderful, that's why I'm hobbling. You know, it's natural expression of care. But we often answer, no, everything's fine, nothing's wrong. You know, so actually one people asked me, a person asked me in the corridor, is everything all right? I said, no, everything's fine. of course, it's not fine. And we often play this game, so we disguise it. We camouflage our pain. Another way that we camouflage our pain, other than just denying it, is we do it with materialism. We present well. We like to groom ourselves and wear the best clothes. I would always tell you young ladies, when you're looking for a boyfriend, don't look for the one who's the best groomed. Don't look for the one who always is sartorially elegant and well-suited and booted. Because he, I tell you, is hiding something. I promise you. He's not elegant, he's not. You're fine with him. The guy that turns up in a suit and tie is always well-groomed, you know, with a hair slick. I tell you, look carefully. He might look like he's going to sweep you off your feet. He might look like a model, but I tell you, he may be hiding something. Because one of the ways we hide something is through physical appearance. We want to manage people's impression of us. So physical appearance is one of the ways that we signal to people that we're okay when we're not. So a person who's come from a broken background, who's been damaged by life, well, no, I mean, just because a guy's handsome and wears a suit doesn't mean he's damaged goods. But if he's always like that, he always presents, you never see him scruffy. That's a red flag for me, I gotta tell you, as a counselor, that's a red flag. And I've seen that again and again in people. It's not necessarily the case, of course, so if you stipulate rules about these things, but it could be a red flag. And we not only use clothing and hairdos and shoes to hide, but we also use general materialism, buying a new car or a new house, or just generally presenting our lifestyle in a way that is luxurious or looks impressive. We do this on social media. You know, I have all these great dinners and all these great expensive holidays. We may show that to the world, and actually we may be hiding something. And you can maybe think of people that you know who have used social media to present themselves in a rich or positive way. How they respond to be successful, affluent, but actually they're hiding a deep pain inside. And that's, we use materialism to hide. So don't hide your hurt. We need to be able to bring our hurt out to find healing. Now, in the church, it should be a place where there is healing. The church is called to be a hospital for people who are hurting or sinful. We should be a place where people can have a certain degree of openness, where there can be honesty and authenticity without us making silly or judgmental comments. Please be careful what we say to people. We can, you know, I'm not sure I'm a first offender, but we can easily say insensitive, silly, or hurtful things to people. Please be thoughtful, think before you speak, in the church especially. People should be able to come to church and share their pain without getting a judgmental comment back, or without getting an insensitive or silly comment back. We should be a community where people can share their identity, their confusion, and their pain, and simply be loved and encouraged, and helped gently along the journey to find the truth and to find healing. There is healing when you can share honestly, when you can find out somebody else has the same problem that you do. I was talking yesterday to my friend, the doctor, who works with big children with cancer. And I said, it must be a terrible thing to for parents, you know, to be dealing with cancer, and how does it affect them? So I was thinking about the sermon. How does it affect them when they're dealing with the knowledge that their child has terminal cancer? And she said, well, of course it's terrible, and they go through many things, many stages, but she said there's one thing that parents of children with cancer have, and that is that they have a support group, because there's quite a number of parents of children who've had cancer. It's not unheard of in our society. So that means that there's support. And so for the parents, that's key. To help them recover, they need the support of people who've also had children with cancer. Now that may seem like a terrible thing, but here's the point. If you've had an experience that no one else has had, it's incredibly lonely. If you have a disease that no one else has, that they don't understand what you're going through, it's incredibly lonely. If you have a child with a particular kind of illness or autism, and you know nobody else who has the same experience, it's incredibly lonely. When I was 9 or 10 years old, my best friend Tommy, I've shared with you, got a very rare form of bone marrow cancer that happens like 1 in 2 million people. And Tommy had this cancer, the leukemia, and he died. Bone leukemia, I guess it is, and he died. And it was incredibly lonely for his mom, Mary, because there was no one in our community who had a child with such a condition. There was no one who could understand. And so my mother had been a nurse who was quite empathetic, so Mary latched on to mom and would regularly come and see mom and have coffee with mom and come to the kitchen and have a cup of tea and talk with mom. And every year on Tommy's birthday and on the anniversary of Tommy's death, Mary would ring up mom and make an appointment to go to the botanical gardens and walk among the flowers. And she would never say, it's Tommy's birthday, can I walk with you in the flowers? It's Tommy's anniversary of his death, can we have coffee? But mom knew. She knew. And so they would just meet and talk about girl stuff, girl talk, and look at the flowers, and talk about the plants, and very often Tommy didn't come up. But it was all about grieving, because Mary had nobody who had been through the same experience as her. And one of the things that the church can provide is the church can provide a community of people, some of whom have been through what other people are now going through. So if you've been through adultery or divorce, you may be able to help someone else who's going through adultery or divorce. If you are going through a sickness or cancer of a loved one, you may be able to help someone else who's going through that. If you're going through abuse by parents or you've been abused by parents, you may be able to help someone else who's been through that. If you've been through simply the loss of losing a father or a mother, then you will be able to understand and empathize and help and support someone else who has been through that. So don't hide your hurt. We need to find people who maybe have been through what we've been through and seek their support and their wisdom, their counsel, and their company, because they in their heart will understand what we're going through. Even if they can't put it into words, they will understand your broken heart, your wounded heart. And that is a great comfort to be able to talk to someone like that. In James 5:16, it says, confess your faults to one another that you may be healed. And I don't think this just means confess your sins and you'll have miracle healing. I think it means when we talk about our problems and our brokenheartedness, we find emotional healing as well as physical healing. So don't hide your hurt. And in the church, we need to be a healing community for people. So one of the reasons we need to share testimonies, we need to say, I've been through this, because there may be somebody there who needs to say, hey, can I talk to you? Because I'm going through what you went through. And they won't know. How will they know? Unless we share our testimony. Or we could start a recovery group. If you're a recovered alcoholic, or you're recovered this or recovered that, we could start a group for people. We're a very small church, but you've got the idea, I think. And all you need to do in a group like that is just listen. Just be there for people who are going through a similar experience. It's an idea, anyway. Number four. And this will come as a surprise to some of you, but we should not be, we should try not to worry about it. If you have a hurt and you worry about it, it doesn't change it. Worry is an attempt to control the uncontrollable. One thing that some people do, if people are clever, they have a powerful mind, they're used to applying their mind to solve problems. When they encounter a child with cancer, or they encounter a personal overwhelming crisis which is uncontrollable, what they will do is do what they always do. They'll apply their prodigious intellect and ability to the problem. And they will hammer away at it with their mind, and their energy, and their intensity, because that works. It works in the professional world. It works in business. It works in life. But it doesn't work with cancer. It doesn't work when something in your personal circumstances is broken. If something is incurable or unfixable, it doesn't help to work at it with all your intellect and your power. And sometimes we feel we can solve problems by throwing all our money and our mind and our intelligence and our energy at something. And actually what we're doing is just worrying about something we can't fix. We're trying to control the uncontrollable. Now, this is tricky, because some of you are possibility thinkers, and some of you think, if I just try hard enough, I can solve that problem. But actually, there are some problems that we can't solve in life. Doesn't mean we shouldn't try, but we also should know when to stop. We should know when to relax and give it to God and say, well, I've done my best, but I'm not going to continue to worry at this, because actually I can't solve it. And it's a kind of idolatry when we think that we can solve the unsolvable, or we can heal the incurable. We're playing God, as it were. So worrying about something doesn't help. In Job chapter 5, verse 2, Job says, to worry yourself to death with resentment is foolish. It's a senseless thing to do. It never solves the problem. So that's number four. So we have don't ignore it, don't run away from it, don't hide it, don't worry about it. And number five, don't resent it, don't become bitter. Resentment also doesn't help. You notice that all of these strategies, which are our go-to strategies when we're hurting, all make things worse. They all make things worse. Resentment, we do this when people hurt us, we become angry, cynical, bitter, we get self-pitying. In Job 18:4, it says you're only hurting yourself with your anger and bitterness. We're all familiar with the person who is so bitter that they're actually hurting themselves. They're not hurting the ones who hurt them, they're helping themselves. The ones who hurt them have already moved on. But by their bitterness and their unforgiveness, they are hurting themselves. Resentment and bitterness never hurts anybody but you. It doesn't hurt the offender. It just continues to hit you. Okay, so these are five things that we should not do. So what is it we should do? We'll find the answer to that if you turn over the page, page 18. We find the answer to that in our verse today, the 23rd Psalm and verse 5. Interestingly, at this point, the scenery in the psalm changes. Up until now, we've been at a feast. The shepherd has been leading us to green pastures and to a table, to a feast. But it changes to a feast. We've been in the field of green pastures, and then it moves to a feast table. So it moves from the field to the feast. And David uses the imagery of a banquet, a human banquet. No, it's no longer a sheep banquet anymore. Now it's a human banquet. And he uses three steps that we can take to allow God to heal our hurt. So you prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, and my cup overflows. Here are the three steps. Number one, let Jesus settle the score. He prepares a table for you in the presence of your enemies, in the face of your enemies. We want to fight and destroy our enemies. Of course, there is a place for seeking justice and for making sure what's happened to us doesn't happen to other people. Of course, that's right and sensible. But if we do it with a heart full of vengeance, it's only going to hurt us more. If we do it with a heart of bitterness, it's not going to achieve what we want it to achieve. So don't try to get even. Don't seek revenge. As Christians, we are told not to retaliate against those who hurt us. We are taught by Jesus in the sermon to turn the other cheek. Trust God to even the odds. Trust Jesus to settle the score. Give it to God. Let God deal with it. David says, you prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. Now sheep have many enemies. Wolves, bears, snakes, ticks, and even flies. Sheep are defenseless. They have no teeth that are sharp to bite with. They have no claws. They cannot kick. They cannot, most of them cannot buff. They don't have horns. Only the goats do, maybe. They can't run away. They're absolutely the most defenseless silly animal that there is. They don't know how to do anything. They cannot be safe unless there is a shepherd to protect them. And the job of the shepherd is to find a good flat land, a field of green grass, and to drive away the enemies. So he brings the sheep and he gives them a safe place to eat. He looks for the pasture and he drives out the enemies. In Romans 12, God says, let me handle those who hurt you. Never pay back evil for evil. Never avenge yourselves. Leave that to God, for he has said he will repay those who deserve it. In the epistle today that Matthew read, it says that the things we do in the body, we all have to face God, and we have to receive the consequence of our action, whether good or ill. There is a judgment, a consequence before God. God can settle the score. So in other words, God's going to deal with them. Those people who have hurt you or cheated you or ripped you off. There's going to be judgment that they have to face in eternity. And God will settle the score. There will be a judgment day. And he has the resources to deal with the problem, which you don't. So you need to decide, are you going to get revenge or are you going to heal? Are you going to get well? You can't do both. Today, revenge is big business. But it doesn't work. It always backfires. It keeps the pain alive. When you retaliate against the hurt, all you do is escalate your pain. Forgiveness doesn't mean that you're saying, oh, it's okay that you hurt me. That's not what you're saying. And forgiveness is not saying, oh, what you did is not bad. That's not what you're saying. Forgiveness is not saying, I don't hurt. It's not lying about what's happened. When you forgive someone, you acknowledge what you did is bad, what you did is terrible. I still hurt, it's very painful, but I'm going to give it to God. I'm going to commit it to God. It's in his hands, and I choose not to hold it against you. Forgiveness is not denying the evil that's done to you in this world, but it means handing it over to God and letting him deal with it and settle the score. So why should we forgive? Three reasons. Number one, you should forgive because you need to be forgiven by God. And you have been forgiven by God. And because God has forgiven you, he wants you to forgive others. We pray in the Lord's Prayer, forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. So the measure to which we are forgiven is the measure to which we forgive. If we forgive, we will be forgiven. Number two, I've already said, resentment makes you miserable. It makes things worse. And number three, you're going to need more forgiveness. You're going to mess up more in the future. So you need to be forgiven more, therefore you should forgive. Matthew 5:7 says, blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy. It's only as I forgive others that I can be forgiven. So that's number one. Let God settle the score. Number two, let Jesus soothe your wounds. You anoint my head with oil. Shepherds would put oil on the head of the sheep for two reasons. One was to soothe and to keep the flies away, and the other was to heal. The worst enemy of sheep was not the lions and the bears, but the worst enemy of the sheep is the flies. I noticed on TikTok you come across these horrific pictures where people squeeze the skin and out comes all these larvae. You've seen that a lot, they're fly larvae. That's a fly strike. And there is nothing worse for sheep than a fly strike. Because it means that their body becomes a nursery for larvae, for baby flies. And it's agony for the sheep. It's itchy and it's painful. And sometimes you see a sheep knocking its head against a post because it's got the fly strike in its head and it can't get them out. So the shepherd mixes oil with sulfur and he anoints the head of the sheep with the oil and sulfur mixture, which keeps the flies away. But the oil also has a healing, olive oil has an antiseptic healing element in it. So it helps to heal wounds. And so the shepherd would anoint and bind up a wounded sheep, and it would help to heal the sheep.
So Jesus anoints and heals us, and he does it to protect us and to heal us from those, the fly strike.
The enemy, you know, the devil is the lord of the flies. In Psalm 147, it says, God heals the brokenhearted and bandages their wounds. The Lord will not only settle the score, but he will come to me and he will take our hurts, take my hurts, and he will do some repair, do some healing on our hearts. Now, when we forgive others, and we are forgiven, it's instantaneous, but healing takes time. Restoration, recovery takes time. Forgiveness is one thing, but restoration, recovery is another thing. It takes time to be healed. Things don't heal quickly. It takes time for our souls to be healed. We need to allow time for healing. It's a process. You know this. So what does Jesus use to heal us? Okay, so four things Jesus uses to heal us.
This is not in your notes. You have to add some points under that Jesus soothes your wounds. So the first thing is he uses fellowship. I've already talked about that. He uses the body. He uses experience. People who've been through what you're going through now. He uses just people who may not have been through what you're going through, but they can listen and be kind and compassionate and caring. So he uses the body of Christ. He uses others to care for you. I always remember the scene in Crocodile Dundee. Some of you are too young to know that movie, but some of you will remember that guy in Crocodile Dundee. He goes to New York. He's an Australian crocodile hunter. He goes to New York, and he finds that everyone he meets has a psychologist and a therapist and a shrink. And at one day at the party, he says, "What's wrong with you? Don't you have any mates?" The implication being that if you had friends, you wouldn't need psychologists and a shrink. That's not necessarily true, of course. But we understand what he means, that in the fellowship of God's people, we can find people to talk to, we can find friends to listen to us and to care. And it's incredibly important that we become those caring people, that when we have people in our midst who are hurting very badly, that we try to be there for them. We, of course, will not always be perfect. We will fail sometimes to be there for them. But as a church community, we need to do our best to make ourselves available to be supportive and to listen and to spend time with those who are hurting. Number two, so this is fellowship. Number two, God uses prayer. And it's not only prayer healing us, but it's that we need someone to talk to as well. So in prayer, we can talk to God and unload our burden and express our feelings and our concerns in our prayers. Number three, God uses worship. There is power in praise. And that's why I want to have time in worship in the church. Because when we sing to the Lord, it invokes the presence of God, it invites the presence of God. And the presence of God comes with healing his wings. We know that there is healing in praise, and that when we praise God, God works and moves. I had a friend who was very badly abused as a child by a so-called uncle, a male friend of the family, who sexually abused her for many years. And when she was a teenager, she began going to church. And she would just sit in the front row in the church and soak up. It was a Pentecostal church in Sydney and Penrith. And she would just soak up the music from the praise and worship for 45 minutes. And she would just sit there and weep. So all sit there and weep through the worship. And everybody would be singing and clapping and praising the Lord. She would just sit there and weep. And she did that for more than a year. And in that process, God was healing her. And after a year of just sitting and soaking and weeping, she was able to forgive the person who had assaulted her. And by this time, he died, but she was able to go to his grave and say some words and say, "I forgive you," and let it go. And that healing happened in worship. So if you see someone sitting and weeping in worship, just let them be. And then later on, when they stop weeping and they get up, go and offer them a cup of tea. He uses worship. Number four, God uses ministry, prayer ministry, laying on hands and praying for others. This is why we want to have a training for prayer ministry on the church camp. We all need to be able to pray for one another. And we all need to be able to listen. And this, again, relates to what we talked about. If we've experienced something, we can offer support to someone else who's going through that now. But we can also offer prayer ministry to people. Ministry can take many forms. It could be prayer ministry. It could be just listening. It could be bringing them food. It could be, taking them somewhere, a hospital, or getting them vitamins, or
there's many ways to express ministry. But God uses all of these, and many of you are doing this to one another, I know. Thank you, and please keep up the good work. But Jesus soothes our wounds through us, through you, through the body of Christ. Someone once said, He has no hands but our hands, He has no feet but our feet. So Jesus soothes our wounds through the body of Christ, giving support to one another, through these four means of fellowship, prayer, worship, and ministry. And you know that healing always occurs in two phases. There's the sitting down phase where you need to be still, sit still. Now I've injured my knee, I don't know how seriously, but there's probably going to be a sitting stage. I probably need to sit and let it heal. Certainly sleeping last night, it perhaps is a little better in the morning, I'm not sure. But I'm sure there'll be some sitting involved, maybe a cast or something, I don't know. But it doesn't matter, I know that I'll have to be still. And when we're sick, we need to be still, we need to stay home, we need to take time off, we need to rest. But then when we're recovering, there's a get moving stage. If you always just sit home and rest, you're going to atrophy. You're going to, what's the word, forget the phrase. You know, if an elderly person, deconditioning, if you lie in bed in hospital for too long, you instantly start to decondition. You know, being a lazy so-and-so that I am, or I'm already very deconditioned, which is probably why I injured my tendon the other night playing basketball with kids, because I haven't been doing any exercise for a while. So I become deconditioned. So we need to get moving. There's a get moving phase. There's a be still phase and a get moving phase. And that's true for us emotionally. You know, we may have a great emotional trauma, like being rejected or divorced or abandoned or abused or whatever it is. And we may sit in our room and weep for a year. We may sit under the covers and stay home and not come out of our room and eat pizza. And, you know, this may go on for months. But at some point, we've got to get up and go for a walk. At some point, we've got to get up and ring Mary or Ruth and say, hey, can we go to the gardens? Let's go to the Botanical Gardens and get a coffee. I need to go for a walk with you and talk. So at some point, we need to get up, we need to exercise, we need to move. Whether it be physical or emotional, the same thing applies. We need to have physiotherapy. And we need that for our emotional wounds as well as our physical wounds. We need the physiotherapy. We need to get moving. So this is also part of how Jesus heals us. At some point, Jesus is going to say, go for a walk and start moving. You know, and that could be, you know, metaphorically or literally. And the literal moving is helpful for the heart as well as the body. Okay, I need to come to a close. The last one this morning is let Jesus satisfy your need. My cup overflows. In the Middle East, there's a lot of desert. And resources in those days, like wine and water, would be in limited supply. So, who would make a cup overflow? You would not. You would not have a guest and say, let me fill your cup to overflowing. In those days, what they used to do is if someone came for dinner, you would fill their cup. Someone came as a guest to your house, you would fill their cup. And if you were happy with them being there and you wanted to be a good host, you would fill their cup again. And then if you were still happy and you were having a party, you would fill their cup again. But if they became obnoxious and it was time for them to go home, or you just had enough of them, or it was just all out of memory and he was too irritating, you would stop filling his cup. You would tell the servant, don't fill his cup anymore. And he would know it was his outstay, his welcome, and it was time for Uncle Henry to go home. But if you really loved someone, if you really valued and honored guests, what would you do? You would fill their cup to overflowing. And that was a sign in the Middle East that you respected someone, you highly loved them, you appreciated them. So the scripture says in the Psalm, my cup overflows. When we come into the banquet of God, He fills our cup to overflowing. And what He's saying to us is, I love you, I treasure you, you're important, you're an honored guest in my house, I'm not waiting for you to leave, I'm happy that you're here. So, it's a picture of us having a banquet with Jesus. And in the banquet, He serves our wounds, He settles the score with our enemies, He serves our and heals our wounds, and He satisfies our needs. What does our cup overflow with? It overflows with hope. In Romans 15:13, God will overflow with hope in Him through the Holy Spirit's power. There is always hope. Secondly, our cup overflows with love. 1 Thessalonians 3, may the Lord make your love to grow and to overflow. And thirdly, he fills our cup with joy. John 16, ask in my name and you'll receive, and your cup of joy will overflow. God fills our cup with hope, with love, with joy, and with peace if we let him. But we have to come to his banquet. We have to come to his presence. We have to come and let him settle the score. We have to stop doing all those other strategies, all those snake oil that we make. We have to stop ignoring it, stop running from it, stop hiding it, stop worrying about it, stop resenting it and being bitter about it. We need to give it to God, bring it to Jesus, and let him deal with it. So to close today, when God says to you, I want to fill your cup with overflowing, it means that you matter to God, you are precious in his eyes. If you are hurting this morning because someone has hurt you badly, Jesus is inviting you to his banquet. He says, I have prepared a table before you in the presence of your enemies. And I will anoint your head with oil, and your cup will overflow. And he will settle the score, and he will heal the wounds, and he will satisfy the needs of your heart. This is a very good deal. I encourage you not to miss out on it. It's a banquet of wholeness, healing, hope, and salvation. But it's only available when we stop using the snake oil. We lay down all our own efforts, which only make things worse. May we pray. Lord, I thank you for these long-suffering people listening to my long sermons. And I pray, Lord, that this message will be healing and helpful for someone today. Lord, help us truly to make a decision to let go of all our strategies where we try to worry our problems into submission. We try to ignore them into submission. We try to run away from them. We try to hide them. We become bitter and twisted about them. Lord, help us to just surrender them to you. Place them in your hands. Right now, we place in your hands our hurts, the people who have hurt us, the disappointments we've had. And we ask that you would fill our hearts with love and forgiveness for them, that your healing may flow, that you may soothe our wounds and protect us from future woundedness. Satisfy our hearts, Lord, by filling our cup with joy, peace, love, and hope. In your name we pray. Amen. Bless you, friends. This is why the long series is nearly finished. Could you please come back? A seismic, please give a warning to Sunday school that it's time to come back now. Sure, why not? No time right now. When they're ready, now is when they're ready. May we stand and respond in the words of the Creed. We declare our faith together as we say, we believe in one God, the Father of the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God,
eternally begotten of the Father,
God
from life,
true God from true God,
begotten not made,
one league with the Father,
through whom all things were made.
For us and for our salvation,
he came down from heaven.
By the power of the Holy Spirit,
Especially we pray for Juliana and Irene for their baptism next Sunday, for your blessing presence upon them. We continue to lift up Mariam's family, that is Jason, Angelina, and Evangeline. We continue to lift up Ella's family, Ian, and Juliana, and ask for healing on them. We also lift up the family of Chico, who we've been praying for his three children, his wife and his mother, grieving at this time in his family. We give you thanks for a degree of peace in the Middle East, and we pray, Lord, that you would increase the peace and willingness for peace there. We pray for a full and rapid recovery for Chloe. She will have full healing from the surgery and return to us soon. And we pray for a lady with kidney disease, Lord, for your healing hand upon her, to strengthen her and give her freedom from infection and heal the kidney. We pray for all those known for today. We thank you for the birthday celebrants and ask your blessing upon them. May we go forward to the confession. Thank you. Let us join together as we confess our sins, saying together, Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you.
Thank you. Receive these your gifts of bread and wine. According to our Savior's word,
may be partakers of his body and his blood. For on the night he was betrayed, he took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, his almighty Father, he broke it. He gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Likewise, after supper, he took the cup of wine, and again giving you thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the remission of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And we declare together, Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. And we pray,
sanctify these gifts by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son. We offer our prayer and praise, Father, in the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Blessing and honor and glory and power are yours forever and ever.
Amen. And as our Savior Christ taught us, we can join hands with our family members as we pray together,
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
We break this bread to share in the body of Christ.
We do not presume to come to this your table, merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in your manifold and great mercies. We are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs of your table, but you are the same Lord whose nature is always to have mercy. Help us therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of your dear Son Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that we may evermore dwell in him and he in us.
Dear friends, these are the gifts of God for the people of God, his body broken and his blood shed for us. This is the table prepared for us in the presence of our enemies. Let us take them in remembrance that Christ has died for you and feed on him in your heart by faith with thanksgiving. As always, we invite you, if you're baptized and believe in Christ, to come for communion. If you are not yet baptized, you can cross your hands on your chest as a sign of receiving a blessing. Thank you.
Thank you. Oh,
Lord and have lunch.
Thank God.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you for coming, friends. Happy birthday.
Happy birthday to you.
Bye-bye, darling.
I'm hugging you very badly.